One other fascinating claim was made in 2015 relating to gamble. Two US Madeleine researchers, using the Internet Archive website Wayback Machine to investigate the history of the CEOP website, said they had found a record of CEOP setting up a dummy page for Madeleine McCann on their website dated the 30th of April 2007. This is the day after I suspect Madeleine died and 3 days before she was reported missing. If this could be proved, it confirms my theory that Madeleine died on the Sunday, triggering a frantic effort assisted by government agencies to plan a hoax abduction 4 days later. But the owners of the website removed the entry, claiming the entry was invalid. In my opinion, this issue is still not settled. It is fundamentally a technical argument, and I myself, with much experience of internet programming, am not convinced by any of the explanations people have put forward as to why the entry was invalid. Let's just mention a few other paedophile connections to this case. I dealt with Robert Murat earlier and the allegations by two witnesses that he had attacked a young girl and had child sexual abuse images on his computer. He was unable to explain to the police why he had encrypted material on his computer. One of the Praia da Luz residents with whom Murat had business interests and whom he met up with between his early morning flight to Portugal and Madeleine's reported disappearance was a Russian expat, Sergei Malinka. Clearly, they were good friends and business associates. There were also allegations that he too had child abuse images on his computer, but it appears that he wiped his hard drive before the police could get to it. I will also mention Jane Tanner's interview by Leicestershire Police in April 2008. During a series of interviews, she made constant sexual innuendos, for example, about the males in her group needing relief. She seemed to have no idea that to constantly joke about sexual issues and use sexual innuendos in a police interview on a possible child abduction case was abnormal. These were not references to child sexual abuse, but they do suggest that the culture of the McCanns and their friends may have been fairly uninhibited on sexual issues. There is one other very important reason why this constant connection of the McCanns with the subject of paedophilia matters a great deal, and that's because of credible claims that both Jerry McCann and his good friend David Payne had a sexual interest in children. The allegation was especially credible because it was made by two general practitioners who had actually previously holidayed with the McCanns, Dr. Aral or Savio Gasper and his wife, Dr. Katharina Gasper. They were prompted, they said, by seeing the face of Dr. David Payne on television a few days after Madeleine was reported missing. Because of what they remembered happened on their previous holiday with the McCanns and the Paynes, they instantly thought that Dr. Payne might be connected to Madeleine's disappearance. They immediately contacted Leicestershire Police, who took formal statements from them. Dr. Katharina Gasper on the 16th of May said, "I was sitting between Jerry McCann and David Payne, and I think both were talking about Madeleine. I can't remember the conversation in its entirety, but they seemed to be discussing a particular scenario. I remember Dave saying to Jerry something about she, meaning Madeleine, would do this. While he mentioned the word this, Dave was doing the action of sucking one of his fingers, pushing it in and out of his mouth. While with his other hand, he was doing a circle around his nipple with a circular movement around his clothes. This was done in a provocative way. There seemed to be an explicit insinuation about what he was saying and doing. I remember being shocked by that. I always felt it was something very weird and that it was not something anyone should say or do. I looked at Jerry and also at Dave to gauge their reactions. I looked around as if saying, did someone else hear that or was it just me? The conversation stopped for a moment, then we all began conversing again. Moreover, I remember Dave doing the same thing on another occasion. During our holiday in Mallorca, each parent would bathe all the children in turn. I was keen to stay near the bathroom if Dave was bathing the children. I remember I said to Savio to be careful and to be close by if Dave was helping to bathe the children and my daughter in particular. Her husband, Dr. Aral Gasper, said in his statement, "During the period when we stayed at the villa, I remember a gesture made by David Payne. I do not remember the context of the conversation between David and Jerry, but I do remember seeing David use his left index finger to rub his nipple using circular movements, while he put his right index finger into his mouth, touching his tongue. I remember that when I saw this gesture, I immediately thought it to be in very bad taste, independently of the context of the conversation they were having. I don't know if anyone else saw the gesture, apart from my wife, Katharina." Inexplicably, Leicestershire Police held onto these statements for an unbelievable 6 months before faxing them over to the Portuguese police. I suggest this was no mistake either, because they were sent over to Portugal a couple of weeks after Gonçalo Amaral had been removed from his post. I have to ask why any genuine police force would refuse to pass on information like this, which clearly the two Gasper doctors fully intended to be investigated. It seems that Leicestershire Police, or the associated powers that be they were colluding with, didn't want Gonçalo Amaral to know that instead of the possibility of the alleged abductor being a paedophile, he might be dealing with at least two paedophiles within the group of doctors that were claiming Madeleine had been abducted. Now, I want to come on to another video about Madeleine McCann. This was produced by Madeleine's godfather, Liverpudlian filmmaker John Corner, who plays a role in events after the 3rd of May 2007. In August 2007, he spent a week in the McCann's villa filming a video which he then leaked to a BBC Panorama team who made a documentary in 2007 making use of Corner's footage. On the 1st of May 2010, just ahead of the third anniversary of Madeleine's disappearance, Corner released a 2.5 minute video which caused a storm of protest. What caused the protests were these three still images in the middle of the film. One press report explained, "Parents of Madeleine McCann, who went missing 3 years ago, have released a new video and photo of their missing daughter to mark the third anniversary of the girl's disappearance." But the McCanns, up till now, had not in the previous 3 years ever displayed these three controversial photos. If it was explicitly approved by the McCanns, it was certainly a very strange decision. The first one has been called the floorboards photo. This one has been called the ice lolly photo. It was the middle one, however, which caused the greatest adverse reaction. It's been called the makeup photo, for obvious reasons, featuring much blue eyeshadow, a pink hair bow, lipstick and jewellery. She does not look happy. Many call it the Lolita photo. Like the other two photos, it was clearly posed. The photographer must have been positioned well below her head, looking upwards at her. When the video was released and an intense debate began about the choice of these three photos, the McCanns publicly claimed that the photo shows her when she was three after a raid on her mummy's dressing box. Could she have put the necklace on herself? Could she have applied the pink bow to her hair? Could she have applied the blue eyeshadow neatly? Or lipstick? Overwhelmingly, observers agree that the evidence from the photograph suggests that an adult made her up. And of course, an adult was on hand to take the photo. The McCanns have not said who took this photograph. Even if Madeleine had raided the dressing box as claimed, it is one thing to take a photo like that for your family photo album, but it's an entirely different matter to release it for millions to see. The next day, many media noted that Madeleine looked much older than her actual 3 years due to the makeup and jewellery. The Independent newspaper said, "Can the McCanns be thinking straight? To keep their story alive, they have just released a moody video complete with a musical soundtrack which includes a photograph of the 3-year-old wearing makeup and gazing into the camera. It is that image which, predictably, has featured in the media. It seems a bizarre and unsettling development. Clearly, someone should surely have pointed out to them that in a case over which paedophilia casts an obvious shadow, it looks downright weird when a photograph which has the effect of sexualizing the missing child becomes part of the campaign to find her. Even Mark Williams Thomas, despite his unstinting support for the McCanns, was so shocked at the images that he went on his Twitter account stating that it was so inappropriate and so damaging. Another prominent commentator wrote, "I know what a picture of a child playing looks like. My parents have albums of pictures of my sister as a child playing with makeup, dressing up. I also understand when I'm seeing the deliberate sexualization of a child. I also know which end of the spectrum that those images lie. I've previously criticized people for expressing these sorts of views, but when you see the three Madeleine pictures in that video in close succession, you start asking, what's the probability that this is just some sort of accidental pose? I really don't like the answer. I'm not a photographer nor a filmmaker, nor actively involved in the media. And so if I can pick up on these references, then John Corner most certainly can." Newspapers were flooded with similar comments. Here's a selection. And there were hundreds more comments like this, all in the same vein. When I looked through the range of comments about the makeup photo, I found two, both of which I think are very perceptive. "I'm looking at her hair. The fringe is kind of grown out and comes to beneath her eyes, just like the last photo. The one of Maddie by the pool with Jerry and Amelie. If you look at pictures of her a few weeks before in Donegal, her fringe isn't that long. If it was taken before the holiday, it must have been just before, in my opinion." The second comment, also very observant. "Still, I don't understand the purpose of the photo with the blue eyeshadow. Anybody notice that on this said photo, the right side of the background seems to show the same wall as the wall in the new released video? So was the photo taken while on holiday? Is the photo meant to remember somebody who was there when the photo was taken? I have compared the likenesses of Madeleine on the makeup photo with her on the last photo, and I think the similarities are striking. Here are my observations. Madeleine's face appears to indicate that the pictures were taken around the same time. The length of her hair and fringe appears to be identical. In both photos, she is seen wearing a pink hair bow or band. This is unusual, as I can only find two other photos of Madeleine out of many where she has a hairband. They may not be the same bow or band, but clearly on both occasions an adult had been arranging her hair. On both photos, Madeleine can be seen wearing a pink top." Now, in addition to these observations, I note that in the makeup photo, Madeleine is photographed against a pale yellow, ochre-coloured stucco background, of a type rarely seen in England, but very common in Mediterranean countries like Portugal. Moreover, to the right of Madeleine's head is a dark-coloured object, which could be a lamp holder, which again looks similar to the layout of properties in the Ocean Club. Here is an example. The blue object looks as though it might be a blue plastic chair, as shown here. Now, in my previous film, When Madeleine Died, you'll recall that I presented persuasive evidence that the so-called last photo must have been taken on the Sunday, the second day of the holiday, mainly because of the weather conditions. I also showed that there was no convincing evidence of any photos of Madeleine being taken after that date. I suggest that the makeup photo was taken in Praia da Luz that very week. There is no evidence that any photos of Madeleine exist after Sunday the 29th of April. So I suggest that the makeup photo was taken on the same day. Madeleine, to most observers, looks unhappy in this photo. Madeleine was also dressed up for the last photo. She has a pink smock on and she had a pink hair bow or bead. In the makeup photo, she also has a pink top, maybe the same one. She still has a hair bead or bow, maybe different, but now, additionally, she has a necklace, eyeshadow and lipstick. It's a possibility, then, that the makeup photo was taken in the afternoon, sometime after the last photo by the pool. And as I suggested in my last film, I think the time Madeleine died may have been within a few hours of that picture being taken. So is it possible then that the makeup photo is the true last photo of Madeleine? I have covered the subject of paedophilia, of child sexual abuse, in some detail because, as I hope I have shown, it does appear to be relevant in some way to the reported disappearance of Madeleine McCann. By that, I do not mean to accuse the McCanns or any of their Tapa 7 friends of being paedophiles. The only evidence of this, indirect evidence, comes from the statements of Dr. Arrell and Dr. Katharina Gasper, which I will leave for you to interpret. Nor do I suggest that Madeleine was killed at the hands of a paedophile, though in this extraordinary case, I don't think anyone can rule it out. The makeup photo, possibly taken on Sunday, is disturbing. But is it possible that however Madeleine died, by sedation, by accident, or by a violent attack, that there is some kind of hidden connection that the McCanns or one of their friends have to some high-level paedophile ring? Let's not forget also that Peter Hyatt, an expert in statement analysis, concluded that there was a strong possibility of child sexual abuse in connection with this case. There is one more statement, and I hesitate to mention it because it is so graphic, but it is in Kate McCann's book. She describes how she imagined Madeleine having been abused. I told him about the awful pictures that scrolled through my head of her body, her perfect little genitals torn apart. Admitting to the existence of these images somehow confirmed them as a real possibility. Now, what was that doing in her book? On top of all these indications, there is one other obvious mystery that we must explain, and that is the astonishing way in which the government and the security services were all over the case from day one, and maybe even before, if we count Robert Murat's dash to Praia da Luz 3 days before Madeleine was reported missing. What else could possibly account for this, except the cover-up of a potential national scandal over high-level VIP abuse of young children? It can only have been something very big and very bad. If the McCanns were in any way, however loosely, connected to a high-level paedophile ring, that would certainly explain it. I want to briefly examine some other theories that have been put forward to explain this remarkable top-level involvement. These centre around, firstly, the true genetic origin of Madeleine, and secondly, theories that the pharmaceutical industry was involved. Some people have suggested that most of the holidaymakers were swingers on an adult holiday, and that this was the reason for the cover-up. It is said that none of the high-profile attendees wanted to admit they were swingers. Others simply point to the McCanns' existing connections to the rich and powerful, such as Jerry McCann being on the committee of the nuclear energy quango, Comare, along with Gordon Brown's brother, Andrew Brown. One set of theories suggest Madeleine may not have been the child of both parents. These theories have included, firstly, that Madeleine was adopted, or secondly, that Madeleine was a surrogate child, or thirdly, that Madeleine was the result of a sperm donation by a third party. Other theories relating to genetic origin suggest that Madeleine was the product of some kind of genetic experiment, maybe with her DNA having been partly genetically engineered, or that she was a clone. In other words, a secret intelligence genetics or eugenics research program. The McCanns have always insisted that they are the natural parents of all three children. All were conceived by IVF treatment. Madeleine was born after IVF treatment in England, and the twins after IVF treatment in Holland. One curiosity is that, so far as I'm aware, no photo of Kate being pregnant has ever been published. In her interviews in the early days, Kate said little about her pregnancy with Madeleine, describing it as easy and problem-free. In her book, she writes, "My pregnancy was totally without complications. No sickness, no back pain, no bleeding, no swelling. I felt great." And of Madeleine's birth, she said, "There she was, perfect." A specific allegation that Jerry McCann was not Madeleine's father first surfaced in the Portuguese press in the paper 24 Horas in September 2007. The story claimed that senior sources of the Portuguese police believed that they knew who the sperm donor was and stated that he had been traced and had been in England on the 3rd of May, the day Madeleine was reported missing. The newspaper claimed that this had been confirmed by Portugal's National Institute for Forensic Medicine. A source claiming to be from the Portuguese police said, Jerry McCann was not the sperm donor for Maddie. He was the donor for the twins, but it's possible that Jerry himself doesn't know he's not the biological father. There may have been a switch at the laboratory. Another magazine, Tal e Qual, repeated the allegation, causing Clarence Mitchell on Jerry McCann's behalf to issue a firm insistence that he was the true father of Madeleine and to threaten to sue the magazine. Finally, was there a connection to the pharmaceutical industry? Theories that the pharmaceutical industry was involved put forward that Madeleine, and maybe the twins as well, were being subject to a trial, authorised or unauthorised, of some new and potentially dangerous drug, and that a pharmaceutical company may have leaned on Mark Warner and the government to cover up their testing of a drug that was being trialled, which caused Madeleine's death. All this appears to be speculation, though I have discovered that two doctors on that holiday with whom the McCanns were friendly, Dr. Paul Weinberger and Julian Totman, have significant connections with the Government Chemical and Biological Warfare Centre at Portendown, Wiltshire. I had hoped to reach some kind of provisional conclusion about the most likely way Madeleine died, but I find that I simply cannot. I've discussed several ways she might have died, but at present I don't think there is sufficient available evidence to rule any of those theories out. But I firmly believe that she died, that the death was unexpected, and the McCanns and others had a strong reason to cover up her death. Look at this possible clue from Rachel Oldfield, one of the Tapas Seven, published by the Daily Mirror on the 25th of April 2008, just before the one-year anniversary. She was quoted as saying, if you take the common sense approach and look at timings and the fact that they are medics and there are four other medics in the group, they would know what to do to resuscitate a child. Who said anything about resuscitating a child? Where did that come from? Was it a Freudian slip? Perhaps I shouldn't use that word anymore. It immediately raises the possibility that Madeleine had perhaps been rendered unconscious. But if that is what happened, it would line up with all of our scenarios. It would line up with an overdose of sedatives or drugs, an accident, or an attack by one of the parents, or maybe by a third party, so we are none the wiser. And another clue from Dr. David Payne, when he was asked by the police about whether the McCanns had a kit bag for their tennis gear, replied by first saying, they certainly didn't have a great big tennis bag, and then went on to say, but it certainly wasn't a big tennis, you know, things that you could put a tennis racket in. There was nothing of that size that you could hide a tennis racket in or anything like that. Is this a clue that Madeleine's body was carried in a tennis bag? But again, if it is, it still sheds no light on how she may have died. To my mind, there is one theme in this case that tends to dominate all others, and that is the truly vast scale of involvement of the government and its security arms, such as MI5 and Special Branch, in protecting and supporting the McCanns. I gave many details in my first Madeleine film. 10 years on, this active government involvement continues. What might the government wish to cover up above all else? I suggest that they would be most worried if it emerged that senior politicians and members of the government, perhaps very high profile, were revealed to have been involved in very immoral and very illegal acts. High profile people who we think are autonomous might actually be being controlled directly because they have been trapped by security agencies carrying out child sexual abuse. If this was uncovered, it means these high-profile people can no longer hold office, and the security service loses control of their carefully manufactured assets. As we've seen in recent years, this is probably just the tip of an iceberg, with high-level politicians and celebrities being involved in paedophile rings. The McCanns brought paedophilia into their daughter's disappearance from day one. They went on to develop several news stories about paedophile gangs having stolen Madeleine to order. It may be that the McCanns' connection to the world of paedophiles is only slight, but even if they just had personal knowledge and proof of one very key person who was a paedophile, that might just be enough for a panic-stricken government to trigger the huge amount of support from British police and security services, government and media, who all seemed available at the drop of a hat to swing into action on the morning of Friday the 4th of May, and create such a powerful abduction scenario that 10 years on, most British people still believe it. I do not suggest that there is any evidence that Madeleine was killed as the result of an attack by a paedophile. But then, like so many others, I am troubled by the Lolita photograph of Madeleine. It's a very disturbing thought that an adult could make up Madeleine in a highly sexualized way in order to make her available for a paedophile. As for the cause of death, I have taken you where I can, but have not been able to completely rule out any of the suggested causes. And here's where I need your help. If you have any knowledge or view or opinion on what may have happened, please email me. This may be my last scheduled film about Madeleine McCann, but if anything new and credible should emerge, be sure I will be telling you about it. Thanks very much for watching this series of films. Just one final point on why I made these films. I made them to show to the widest audience what mainstream media are really about. If you've watched my whole series, which now amounts to about 14 hours of documentary, please follow these links and watch a BBC documentary about the case and a BBC interview with Robert Murat. With the knowledge you have gained from my films, you can now watch this BBC propaganda in its true context and know fully what they are up to.